First of all, let me ask, do we have any questions? Do we have any questions? If not, then we want to continue with our lesson on Ephesians 4 chapter 24 grace. When we talk about a new life in Christ, the change that came about in Ephesians 3 is a result of learning about Christ. Christ's life and teaching represents the highest standard of spirituality and morality. And there are different religions and founders of religion who presented a high moral standard, an ethical standard, but Christ presented us with the highest moral but also spiritual standard that one can live by. That's like Jesus said to those Pharisees, to the listeners, except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no way be saved. What Jesus recognized and admit that thou were going to adopt some good teaching, the moral teaching in the world, even by those who did not know him. He said, but what God required is not earthly good, not human good. God requires divine good, spiritual good. And so then a person may do a good deed, perform a kind act. They may do it to be seen. They may do it to be heard. They may do it to acquire recognition. And even though it's a good act, they paid the hunger. They paid the mortgage for somebody who's about to be evicted. And Jesus said, that's good. But that's not good. That does not qualify you for a relationship with God, a fellowship with God. Because the good that I require can only be produced in you by the Spirit of God. So that you perform your kind act, you do your good deed, not for self-satisfaction, not to advance self, but because the love of God has been shed abroad in your heart. So that you do good, not only to those who do good to you, you love not only those who love you, but you're able to love the unlovable, but you're able to love those who are mean to you, whatever. It's human good to love our friends. It's human good to do good for people who do good to us and for us. But it's divine good that enables one, and spiritual good that enables one to do good to a person who has done and is doing wrong. You see this in Jesus. Father, forgive them for their knowledge. You see this in Jesus. Give Judas the shot and he wants Judas to. You see this in Judas. In Jesus, as he continues to bless humanity day and night, even though many of humanity does not reciprocate that kindness and that goodness. You know that you're here today, not because you deserve it. It's not by your merit or goodness. I'm here not because of my goodness. I'm here because of the grace, the mercy.
Amen.
I'm here because of God. And you're here because God chose to forgive us of our many sins. God chose to love us in spite of our disobedience over and over again. Okay, so Christ presents the highest standard of spirituality and morality. Truth is in Jesus. Truth is in Jesus. He is truth. And without him, we have truth, my friend. Truth is relative to what he chose to allow man to generate out of his own nature, his all come from God. The ultimate truth, abiding truth, lasting truth, unchanging, you know, they come from. Okay, so we move on to verse 22 and 24. We just talked about that. Paul used the analogy of taking off an old garment and putting on a new one to describe the results of all by repentance of sin and faith in Christ. What happened at the moment you received Christ? You took off your former ways. You began a process of renewal in the spirit of your mind. You put on the new man. I have just written that, but I have also developed it from a different perspective standpoint. And so then Ephesians 4, let's look at Ephesians 4, verse 20 and 21. Let's read together, please. But ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is what? In him. Okay, look at the words of Paul. First of all, he said, what? You took off. You took off. Do we have that on the board? The explanation on it. Okay. You took off your former way. Took off, like you're taking your clothes off. You took off. That's something that you must put forth effort to do. It's not that hard. Now that I'm saved, God will automatically, by the flip of the finger, God is just going to take all the bad stuff away from me and then put on all the good stuff. No. He said, you're in the body of flesh. You are you're both human, and you have both a human nature and you have a divine nature. Now, when you been saved, when you were saved, God bestowed on you a new nature, a divine nature, the spirit man, we call it. But you still have your old nature. You still have that nature that you inherited from whom? From Adam. You still have your flesh, and flesh is not simply this stuff here. Flesh has to do with that nature that is corrupt, that nature that is deceitful, that nature that has been born in sin and shaped in iniquity. It's still not. I don't care how much praying you do, I don't care how much fasting you do, and I don't care how long you think you come. You still do. And where there's humanity, there's imperfection. Where there's humanity, there's failure. So nobody live according to nobody live in the spirit, put it that way, by the dictates of the spirit all the time. And so that's why we have to be mindful. We got to be cognizant. We got to be alert, because there's a devil on the loose, and he's trying to accomplish his will and fulfill his agenda through you, through me, and through anything and anybody he can use. And so then, that's why you feel said the devil made you do it. The devil didn't make you do it, the devil tempted me to do it. And you did, or he tempted me to do it, and I did. Why did you fail for him? Why did you yield? Why did you give in? Why did you carry out the work of the flesh? Why did I? Because I failed to walk in the spirit. The Paul said, if you're walking in the spirit, living in the spirit, conscious of the need of God and his power, the conscious of the need that, of God's power, but also aware that God has placed that power in you by the presence of his Holy Spirit, so I can resist the devil. And if I resist him, he'll flee from me. And so then I fail, because I fail to walk in the spirit. Because I've been told, if I walk in the spirit, I will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So if I fulfill the lust of the flesh, it's because I'm not walking in the spirit. That is, I'm not living a spirit-controlled life. I'm dabbling and dipping, playing with a yielding to the spirit at some standpoint, and then yielding to the flesh in another. So you took off. How did you do it? By repenting. You took off. That's not what. Okay. We took off by repenting. We are being renewed by the Holy Spirit. We are being renewed by the Holy Spirit. You know what God is trying to accomplish? Nobody saved you. What God is trying to accomplish in you, what God is trying to accomplish in the world, through the culture of other countries and whatever. You know what God is trying to accomplish? Christ likeness. That's what he's trying to accomplish. He's not trying to ultimately make you rich. He's not trying to ultimately give you a life of free, totally free from sickness and trouble and ill. God is trying to accomplish Christ likeness in you. And he does it in many different ways. He allows certain experiences, however troubling, however hard, however bad, however painful, God is trying to make you like Jesus. And that's all it is. Well, you know, some folks that's what can get on my nerves. And God knows you need patience. And so you let folks, you may let people allow them to get on your nerves over and over again until you learn how to deal with those folks who get on your nerves. Right? You ought to have the victory and power over your emotions. So that when you let people, why this? When you let people get on your nerves, it simply means that you have relinquished power, influence of your life over to them. It means that when you let folks get on your nerves or something of that nature, it simply means you have given them control over you. And to get on your nerves, they have to exercise a great degree of control over you. Because for somebody to push me, for somebody to get on my nerves, sir, I got to overlook the goodness of God in my life. I got to overlook every day of my life. He is providing and taking care of me. He's going to get on my nerves. But every time I inhale and exhale, I owe you the grace of God. I didn't put any sorrow in the ground, no vitamin D in the sun, but food grow, the people process it. I go to the store and spend a little money to buy the food. But before I can spend the money to buy the food, God put me in a position to make the money. Yes. So there's so many good things. Yes. So many blessed things. Yes. That is in my life, and part of my life. I have to ignore, neglect, forget, treat lightly. To concentrate so heavily on somebody getting on my nerves to the point that they're doing the control. May God be controlled by the love God has for me. May God be controlled by the goodness of God in my life. May God be controlled by the fact that God put me to bed last night and he allowed me to sleep all night, took care of me and got me up this morning, went to Baton Rouge, came back, stopped by Donald and got some food. That's a good time, you know. So I got to neglect all of that. I'm trying to show you something. We should not be controlled by or influenced by nobody other than Jesus. And we ought to tell the truth. We ought to be honest. We ought to rebuke when it's necessary. We are to reprove when it's necessary. We are to disagree when it's necessary. and reap the results of love. Well, if I, you know, if I say this, you know how mad you're going to get. How mad you're going to get. Get mad. You soon get over it. The point of emphasis is that only God should control our lives. But whenever we have to reprove, whenever we have to do, whenever we have to be direct, the Bible tells us to do it in love. I've got to rebuke you, I've got to reprove you, but not as one who is above you, not as your superior, not belittle you, speak the truth with the aim of helping to see just a little bit more of God. Yeah. When we received Christ, we took off the old man. When we received Christ, the next thing, the challenge, is for us to take off the old man. If receiving Christ, take off the old man, does not come automatically. Doesn't come together. I can receive Christ and not take off the old man. That's why he said, you received Christ, Christ was given. So I received Christ, but now he tells me to take off the old man. He didn't say Christ receiving Christ, and Christ was going to take off the old man. The point to receive Christ is God's responsibility, what is his responsibility, to convict me that Christ is God's answer to my sins denied. So God has to present Christ to us. God presented and given us Christ. Is God's gift to us. Me taking off the old man is my gift, not just to God, but my gift to myself, because it's in my best interest if I take off the old man. If I can allow myself and put myself, you see, God offers new management. God said, before you came to me, you were managed by the flesh. You were managed by the world. You were managed by the devil. You were controlled by the lust of the flesh and the pride of life. He said, but now that you have come to me, you're under new management. Now I got to accept the terms. I got to accept the principles. I got to accept the government of this new management. In other words, I can't live in America and follow the laws of America, know the laws of America, and then move to Japan and still live by the laws of America. I have to change my allegiance, my devotion to Japan, so that I might please the authorities of Japan. And as long as I follow Japan's law and Japan's requirement, I'm not going to be in trouble. I can also benefit from what? The culture of the Japanese. It makes sense. You can't enjoy the benefit of another country if you're going to break the rules of that particular country. And what Paul is saying, God has given you Christ, has taken you out of the kingdom, the country of darkness, and he has transformed you into the kingdom of light. Now when you were over here in the kingdom of darkness, you lived a certain way, you were guided by certain principles, you did certain things. But now that you're not in this country anymore, you've been transformed by the grace of God into another kingdom. Amen. Your responsibility is to learn of the principles, the rules, the regulations, the guidelines, the responsibility, but also the privileges of this particular country. And if you follow the principles of this country, you're going to enjoy the benefit and the privilege of this country. But you got to do that. You have to, 12th chapter of Romans, 1st verse, present your body a living sacrifice. You have to what? Submit yourself to. You have to yield yourself to the government of God. And that's the only way you get the benefit from it. You know what the problem is, though? We want to enjoy the benefit of this country and yet live by the dictate of this country. We want to satisfy the flesh and at the same time reap the benefit of the spirit. That's the problem. That's the problem of the church. We want the goodness of this kingdom, but we also want the fleeing lust of this country. I don't want to change. You see it in all areas of life. You see it in all areas of life. We cool. We get to know each other. We go out together, and all of a sudden, we decide we're going to get married. Now, we get married. But the husband still want to go out with his boys and spend as much time with the boy. He still want to go to the family. As a married, now you stay home. And we'll meet up back at Baker. Don't worry. When you get married, what is a wife do? You get married. It means you have abandoned the ways of single life. I don't think we understand what y'all are talking about. Are we talking about that life of selfishness, where I do what I want to do, when I want to do it, as long as I want to do it? I make the decision, unilateral decision about myself. You have no say so in this. That ain't gonna work. That ain't gonna work. Sooner or later, there's gonna be some conflict. We can't live in marriage like we live when we're saved. Because we're no longer two, we're one. And no longer is my thing. I do what I want. It's us there. We do each other. But that's what it is, Billy. That's what it is. Take off you. It's your responsibility to say no to those things that hinder your walk with God. It's your responsibility to say no to those things that keep you from accomplishing the thing that God has called you to accomplish, keep you from striving for and making progress toward the goal that God has for you when he saved you, and that is to be like Jesus. And anything that hinders you, your being like Jesus, you have to abandon. No sermon can take it from you. No prayer can take it from you. Sermon can suggest. Sermon can make clear. Sermon can tell you the benefit of taking off the old man. But the will is going to determine your, how you exercise your will is going to determine whether or not you receive the benefit of the new life. And you can let other things stand in the way. But you do it to your destiny. If any man decides to come after me, let him deny himself. And which means self-denial. Because you can deny yourself something. But that something you deny yourself is nothing, not meaningful to you. See, I can deny myself alcohol. But I haven't drank alcohol since 1977. So no big deal. I can deny myself a lot of things that doesn't mean anything. But self-denial is denying yourself those things or that thing that you really love and care about and that you feel you can't get. It's the chronic smoker denying himself a cigarette. It's the alcoholic denying himself a drink. It's the placebo and denying himself another option. I don't run around. I know you don't run around. Because you can't run around. I don't get credit for not running around because I can't run around. I get credit for not running around. I can run around and got to fight the whole thing. That's when you get the credit. Y'all don't know nothing about that because y'all never run around. I never run around. But anyway, they try to put it in human language, in human experience. All right, so you're being renewed by the Holy Spirit. You're being renewed. And the more, listen to me, the degree of progress that you make and the likeness of Christ that develops in you will be determined by your yielding to Christ. You're being renewed. God is trying to make you like Jesus. And the more you yield to Him, the more you obey Him, the more you communicate with Him through prayer and reading His Word, going to determine and decide how fast, you might say, how quick you develop into the life of Christ. You're going to decide. There are some choices you have to make. You may be with friends who might be hindrances. And I don't want to hurt their feelings. What's more important, hurting their feelings of being true to Christ? In fact, I don't know if you're feeling, but you also may be thinking here, because maybe they would change if they see commitment in you. If they see dedication in you, if they see what your priority is, then being truthful to you, you might like it. But at the same time, you might get them to think about the quality of their own life and the needs of their own heart. And so then, we don't help people all the time by making it easy for them or doing what we think they want us to do. We help people sometimes by hitting them square between the eyes. That's what Nathan did. This man had one sheep living in him, and that man took his only sheep. What should happen to him, David? He should be killed. You the man. You took your wife's wife, you had to be killed when all the other sisters in the kingdom could have been. He hit David between the eyes. And in that David, David said, Lord, create me a clean heart. Renewing your right spirit, he came to grip with and he came to admit that he had a filthy, corrupt, dirty, low-down heart. And so, okay, go ahead and put the neck. And then he said, put on. It's not, the Christianity is not about simply about taking off. It's also about putting on. It's not simply about taking off hate. It's about putting on love. It's not simply about taking off selfishness. It's about putting on selflessness. So, Christianity, I don't do this, I don't do that, I don't do this. Nearly the Chinese philosopher said that don't do unto others, long before Christ said, don't do unto others what you don't want them to do unto you. And so Christ said, nearly I've already said it, simply. Christ took it out of the negative. Don't do unto others as you don't want them to do unto you. Christ put it in positive and he said, do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. You don't get no credit because you don't steal from a person. You get credit for giving to those who are in need. You don't get no credit for not knowing, not throwing water on a drowning man. You get credit for throwing out a lot of them. That's what you get. But you can pray for what you do, not pray for what you don't do. Because that is not a religion of don't. I don't drink, I don't lie, I don't run around, I don't steal, I don't this. If we poke in jail, I don't do that either. Because they can't. They're not going to talk. That's I said it no more with the love. That's what you see in Genesis. When God put the stipulation on Adam and Eve, you can eat up all the fruit or not. Why stipulate? Why? Because Adam and Eve were not righteous. At that time, they were created. They were not righteous. Because they were innocent. But God wanted righteousness. And the only way that you can have charm on whether Adam and Eve going to be righteous, they got to be given a chance to not be righteous. And so then the test is going to determine whether you become righteous or unrighteous. They failed the test. That's when they became unrighteous. And unrighteousness resulted in all the trouble that they had. So we are called upon not just to not to do bad, but to do good. Not to hurt folk, but to help. Not to put down on them, but to help lift them up. That's what we're called to do. Amen. Okay. And so then, what we see that Paul uses an analogy to describe the change that takes place when one repents of sin and exercises faith in Christ. What happens when they repent of sin and exercise faith in Christ? Not just repent of sin. As I said earlier, when you repent of sin, God forgives, deposits His Holy Spirit in you. You become a new creature. That's when you repent of sin. But he said also when you exercise faith. You see, when you repent of the sin and through the Son of Jesus Christ as your Savior, you become a new creature. But now you have to exercise faith in what this new relationship involves. So I accept Jesus as my, I repent of my sin, Lord, I'm sorry. I accept Christ as my Savior. He comes in and He lives in me. And so then I accept Christ as my Savior, and the result is I become a new creature, a spirit man, a new creature in Christ. But now I need to learn and know what this new relationship involves. Lord, I accept Christ as my Savior. So what? What does it mean? What does it involve? What are the do's and don'ts of what are the benefits? And so then here it is. Faith. Faith strength. When I accept Christ as my Savior, become a new creature and all of that, and exercise faith. Faith in what? Well, faith in Christ. Faith in Christ is person. He is. Who is he, Ferdinand? He is the Son of God. He is very God himself. In him, according to Paul, dwelt all of the fullness of for a woman, all of the fullness of God, the Godhead, in Christ. So I put my faith in the fact that Christ is God himself. His portion. I believe in faith in what? In the sinlessness of God. A sinful person could not atone for the sin. A sinful person cannot and could not atone for the sin of a sinful, another sinful human being. So if Christ paid the price for my sin, if he atoned for my sin, if he became the sacrifice for my sin, then evidently he had to be different than me. I'm a sinner. Christ was no sin. I had sinned. Christ had no sin. So I got to believe in the sinlessness. Not only is he God, but he's sinless. He's fully God, but he's also fully human. Because in order for a human being to be delivered for his sin, or for the sin of a human being to be atoned for, it must be by another human being. That's why the Hebrew said the blood of bulls and goats does not take away sin. So I got to believe in the person of Christ. I got to believe that he is God. I got to believe that he is sinless. Well, before sinless. I got to believe that Christ is God. And I got to believe in what we call the apostolic union, that he is man as well. God, Christ is God, and he is man. He is fully God, and he is fully man. But he, unlike other men who sin, he is a sinless man. He was a sinless man. And so he qualified to pay the price for my sins and your sins because he had no sin. I got to believe that. And I got to believe that once he died on that cross, he did not die for himself. He died for me. He died for you. I got to believe that. That's my faith. And because he has died on the cross, I got to believe that I am, according to the Bible, accepted in the beloved. He has changed my state from that of a sinner to a saint. He has taken me out of the kingdom of darkness, and he has brought me into the kingdom of light.
That's right.
He has changed my state. He has changed my destiny. I was on my way to hell, but now I'm on my way to heaven. He has changed the very nature of life with me, because when I was Christ, I was weak and blind, and I'm going to show you that tonight. Sinful. But now that I've accepted Christ, I'm no longer weak. I'm a portion of life, I see, and a portion of power. I'm more than a conqueror. I'm liberated. That's what the faith is. And when your faith say that and tell you those things about yourself and your relationship with God, then you live in the power of the Spirit, and you live in the blessings of eternal life. So you want joy? Don't work yourself till you get to a bad day and try to make all the money you can, try to do all this. You provide for yourself, but don't be deceived. Money cannot make you happy. Money can't keep sickness off of your mouth. You want joy? It's in him. You want peace? It's in him. You want satisfaction? It's in him. You want meaning to life? Is in him. You want to make sense out of all of this stuff that you're going through, you can only find it in him. Without Christ, without God being equipped, life doesn't make sense. Because here's a 5-year-old child, a 3-year-old child, that is greatly blessed. Here's a 2-year-old child, with his mother, so he was shot down by a carjack. He got to grow up. Without Christ and without spirituality, life does not make sense. It's only as you prove God in your Christian. That's what Christ does. Relationship with Christ, being in Christ and Christ in you, it opens your eyes to see life in a different way. And help you to move beyond interpreting life from the standpoint of time so that you can interpret life from the standpoint of eternity. Therefore, you don't permit yourself to get more of a custom than it's in this place. You're like the old lady who said, when I was at my church back in the 60s and 70s, I got a check on Salvation Bank, and one day I expected to cash it. I did a lot for it. She couldn't talk to herself. I talked to her. But she had some insight. Mother's wit. spiritual enlightenment to tell her that the banks down here will not hold all of them as a bank up yonder. Well, you can really make some good withdrawals. But you can't withdraw unless it's deposit. So you deposit good in the life of others, deposit kindness in the life of others, deposit patience, understanding, and encouragement. Give that, you reap what you sow. Be well of others. Be like Esther when they give this occasion for Frank Sanford. And they had him up decked out, and they were celebrating Fred for his accomplishment. We got all the Fred families here, all the Fred friends, and they're going to have a few words to say about Fred. Bubba gets up, and Bubba coming up and knowing Fred for a long time. And this, that, the other, people come. Somebody else got up, I've been knowing Fred too for quite some time, he said. And Esther got up, she said, I've been told, if you can't say nothing good, don't say nothing. She said, thank you. Do good, and good will come back to you. It may not come back to you in the way that you think, but it will. Amen? Okay. What's happened when you accept Christ? You took off the former life. That's the way of life you put off. You begin a process of renewing the spirit of your mind. It stops in your mind. You say, put away. You have to put some things away, and then you got to put some things on. I share that with you. And so, when you think about it, I think about it. This let me see the fire. Did I put it down? I'm not really sure. Anyway, what it means is this, that we're called upon to put off the grave clothes. Put off the grave clothes and put on the grace clothes. That's what I'm thinking. I'm going to show you this. Put off the grave, G-R-A-V-E. Put off the grave clothes. Put on the green screen and see how life changed for you. Listen to me, words. When you say being renewed in the spirit of your mind, it's not something restored. You said be restored. You said be renewed. Because it's not something to be restored, because if you're outside of Christ, you never had. You never had this type of mind. God is behind the change in believer's thinking and in believer's life. The Bible says, work out the salvation with trembling and fear, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do. He didn't say both to do and will. You got the will. You got the desire to do good. Then it comes. But it is God who is working in you both to will and to do. It is God who is urging you and reminding you that the path that you're on is not leading to any eternal good. It's God that makes you want to do better. It is the urge, the desire to do better, to change. It's God's the one who's working in you. And if you yield to that, if you accept that, if you acknowledge that, then he gives you the power and the ability to do that which you desire to do. And the reason why we not, because this is that, the reason why we don't do better is because we don't desire to do better. We're satisfied with doing better. You have to desire to be stronger in the Lord. You have to desire to represent him in a better way than what you're doing. There's no indictment against what you're doing. It's not to condemn you for the past, but it is to encourage you to develop a greater zeal to be more and more like Jesus. I want to be a better husband. I want to be a better father. I want to be a better pastor. I want to be a better neighbor. I want to be a better person. And if I really want that, God will work in me and give me the grace to be a better this and a better that. But if you're satisfied where you are, if you compare yourself with other folks who have less accomplishment, then you remain. You can reach for the cloud, or you can reach for the star.
Come on.
It's up to you. You can be a better preacher. You can be a better teacher. You can be a better choir. You can be a better husband. You can be that. I want to be a better usher. So if I want to be a better usher, I'm going to start with smiling more. I'm going to say, you know what? I'm going to smile a little bit more. I'm going to pay attention to those who come into the house of the Lord. And I'm going to be aware, Sister Scott, that there are folks who come into the church, they've been hurt, they've been rude, they've been battered. They hurt, they come into, they're sick, they come into a hospital. They're looking for a diagnosis, they're looking for some x-ray, they're looking for, in the final analysis, they're looking for a prescription. They're going to help them feel different. I just got called everything but a child of God when I left home. I turned in front of this motorist, and I don't know what he was saying, but I could read his lips. And I finally get to church, and I meet with the first one I look at, the first one I meet is old Crouching. I need a smile. I need a handshake. I need a good moment, good to see you. Glad to have you. You know? I need somebody to give me something sweet. I've been sucking on a lemon all week. I need somebody to give me something sweet. And so then that's what I do. Bishop, the pastor is out in ministry. Because the people out there, they're hurting. They're having bad experiences in many cases. The check isn't coming. The children don't cry. I don't need nobody looking for me telling me all how bad I am. Matter of fact, Grandma, I know more than you know how bad I am. I don't need you to butter me up. I don't need you to blow smoke. But I need you to tell me something about this gospel that I understand me. Glad story. I heard somewhere, I can't remember exactly when, but I heard somebody say something about God is a forgiving God. This is what I've done, this, that, and that. I wonder if God can forgive me. I need you to let me know, help me know that, yes, I'm not all in. I can be forgiven. That was a place for me in this world. That's the work that has been assigned to my hand. And though I've been neglected for years and years, yet it's not too late. I got breath in my body. It's not too late for me to get up from where I am. I've been in the hall for a long time. But I've come to my right mind. And I need to know that I can go back to my father. I can go to the Father's house and my father, if not like, I hold out for coming. Put down and rub my face in, and every time I see him, he reminds me of our old honor. I need to know that there is somebody willing to accept me as I am, you know, but love me enough not to let me stay as I am, you know, but to change my life. That's what I need to hear from the man of God. I don't need no flowchart. I don't need no body up here or doing anything and performing that. I'm not here like I would be at a concert to be entertained. I don't need entertainment. My heart is hurting. My heart is bleeding. Amen. I'm lonely. Yeah. I'm fearful. I don't know if I'm a baby. I'm waiting on a report from the doctor. I don't need nobody up here on stage doing that thing. Because you might give me a shot of adrenaline while I'm here in the arena, but when I leave the arena, I got to go back and I thank you. I'm telling my wife that, and we keep talking along these lines. I said, yes. I said, a woman died on loose. And I look at that over all the time. Women that are, woman down loose. Our women in this church, they show another church, they show other seven, and even show the jail. And women were behind bars, listening to the speaker. Women, woman, dialed loose, and the speaker was speaking dynamic, responding. Woman, dialed loose. Yeah, yeah. And those women were inquisitive, and they were clapping and shouting. But after the speaker went off, you have to go back to yourself. You can give me a little shot of adrenaline. Make me feel good. Make me temporarily forget about my situation. But the point of emphasis, I need a permanent solution. I don't need a temporary fix. Go back and get that fellow out there with me. But after a while, it will come down on that. They were in another fix. But I need a fix. That is, I need a fix that's going to lead me. Not I, but that. I need a fix that is going to give me a better outlook. That's going to give me hope. Am I coming to you? That's the kind of fix I need. I need a fix that is going to put my heart at ease and wipe away my guilt. And no matter what you have done for it, this here, if you take this, it's going to deal with all the past wrong, all the present wrong, and any wrong in the future. It's going to deal with it. And when you face your Savior, He's going to tell you, brother. Amen? Yeah. To be renewed in the spirit of your mind requires the daily exercise of prayer in the Holy Spirit, who is our resident teacher. He is the teacher who lives on the inside of us. He will cleanse our minds of distracted thoughts and concern so that he can take the eternal truth of God's word and instill them in our mind. When you come, the Holy Spirit, clean your mind. He'll clean your mind. He will unburden you. Jesus said, come unto me, all you that are heavy and heavy burden and heavy labor. He will unburden you. He will take the junk out of your mind and the junk out of your heart. He will take the burden out of you and he give you his peace. And he teaches you and enables you to live in that peace. Stand fast, Paul said, in the liberty wherein Christ has set you free. And be not again entangled with the yoke of bondage. You don't have to go back to that old way of doing things. You don't have to go back to those bad habits. You don't have to go back to those bad thoughts and thinking. You don't have to entertain hatred. You don't have to entertain jealousy. Pride and selfishness. You don't have to hold grudges. You don't have to work for for something bad to happen to those who have done bad. You don't have to live that way. You can live free of these sinful things. You can have peace in Christ. So that you come to a point where you can say like Paul, I learned to be content. James, it wasn't miraculously bestowed on me. I learned how to be content. Because I went through some things that test my patience. I learned to be content. I struggled in my own strength. I applied my own solution. I had all the answer system. But I learned that none of those things worked out. None of those approaches solved my problem. I learned. And I learned when I realized that I just couldn't do it myself. And I learned that my strength was too weak. My knowledge was too limited. I learned that what I thought was the right choice was the bad choice. I had to go through all of that. And then I finally turned it over to Jesus. And I stopped going to God. And I prayed and I just couldn't see. But I stopped worrying about it and give it to Jesus. And began to be in His Word and then concentrate, not just reading His Word, but studying His Word. And again, studying the lives of others who embrace His Word and see the difference and the change that He made in other folks' lives. And I began to watch the folks all around me. I'm talking about my very major Christianity. And I saw people like Sam Bob, who didn't have the literary knowledge. But I saw him shout, Floristine. And I saw how they embraced God, how they loved God. You know what I'm talking about, sister? They loved God. They shouted. They didn't have the honor. I said, his thing was what? His thing was what? And God guided and directed me to believe and depend and trust Him, to give myself the learning of Him. And the more I learned of Him, the more satisfied I became. The more I learned of Him, the more I experienced Him. And it helped to bring me to where I am today. I don't criticize the old church. Didn't have the theology. I don't criticize
the
old Christian.
That's right.
Didn't have the theology.
Yeah.
I thank God that step by step, moment by moment, day by day, He brought me to where I am today. And notice that God is in control of the circumstances of your life. And rather than grumble and complain and find fault and point finger at fault, you ask God in every situation of your life, Lord, what are you trying to tell me today? What are you trying to teach me today? What is it that you're trying to get me to give up? What is it that you're trying to get me to embrace? Teach me. Teach me. When the grace called to the big Hannah, I don't remember exactly his name. But anyway, he was chipping with Michelangelo. He painted whatever it's called. So he was chipping over there. And the Bible asked him, you just chipping on that rock. What are you doing? He said, I'm trying to release the angel that is in this rock. You remember that? No, I'm trying to tell you, there's an angel in you. And that angel has been covered up by flesh. The desire has been covered up by bad habits. That angel has been covered up And God says, I give you grace. Y'all get over here? God says, I give you grace that you can take this, take of this ice pick of mercy, this ice pick of knowledge.
Come on.
You can chip away at the rock that is hide that anger that is in this. Chip away at it. Get away from foolish, stupid people. To get with folk who can help you to chip away and help you to release the anger that is in you. There is a good that is in you. There's more good in you than bad. But if you will do nothing with the bad will ascend to a level where it controls. You got to, you see, you don't have to do, nobody talked you out of lockup. Nobody brought you to the room and said, look, sit down, I'm going to teach you how to lie. Now this is the way to lie. You didn't have to teach you how to lie, that comes automatic. They didn't teach you how to do wrong. They didn't have to teach you how to deny. That comes automatic. Folks have to teach us how to do good, how to teach us how to not be selfish. Look at them children. They're playing and stuff. But this is my ball. I don't want to give up my ball. And they take my ball from it, I cry and run in the corner. Children are automatically selfish. We are simply selfish. We want to have power. The prayer, Bible reading, doing good will help chip away at that selfish nature of ours and release the anger that's in us. Now, something I want to tell you, I'll be close. The Bible like this was written to be obeyed, not simply to be studied. The Bible was written to be obeyed. And not simply, I study the Bible. I read the Bible. But the Bible wasn't written simply to be studied and to be to read. It was written for you to obey. Because only when you obey that you get to bear. The fact that we have been called in Christ ought to motivate us to walk in unity. We've been called in Christ, so we ought to walk in unity. We ought to love each other. This is what is missing in many cases when we come down to the Christian life and to the Christian church here. This is what we have. We've been saved. We've been walked in the same blood. We've been bought with a price. We've been set on our way to the direction of heaven. And yet we live as if we're going in different directions. If we have been saved, if we have been brought to the Christ, if we are the recipient of God's grace and God's mercy, then we ought to encourage one another, we ought to love one another, we ought to help one another to be all that God would have us to be. But sin is a powerful being and is effective. So that though we have been saved by the same God, saved, walked in the same blood, saved by the same grace, yet we treat each other as if we are going in different directions. You say, if he changed something, he should have said, I could have done better than that. Well, what about that? Yeah, I tell you what, I used to trust him and believe, but now I tell you what, I'm skeptical. I don't believe it. Satan is at work with all of us. You know why I know that way with all of us? Because if we're talking about fault, we're talking about failure. Every one of us in share that element of life. Do you understand? So why should I destroy you or try to destroy you because of your failure when I feel pain? It doesn't mean you go along with me for long, but it means that whatever you have to do and whatever I have to do, we do it in the spirit of love. And I do it for not to hurt you, but to help you. And I remember why I'm doing it and who I'm doing it for. And even though I don't want to do what you ask me to do. But because I recognize that it's a blessing, it's a privilege to be able to serve the Lord and to be the recipient of the gift and the ability that He gives me. I can't tell you, God, I can't say no, all because I don't like who directs and I don't like who preaches and I don't like who doing this. I don't like who doing that. What about this God who loves us? What about this God who saved us? What about this God who gives us gift? What about this God who has placed an assignment upon our lives and expect us to honor Him? There's nothing you can do. Do you hear me? There's nothing you can do to stop me from preaching. There's nothing you can do to stop me from teaching. Because when I think about scriptures of the Lord and all that He's done for me, when I think about how He has brought me from a mighty Lord, when I think about how I turned my daddy caught upside down in the canal, and I got out without a scratch and walked home. Well, I walked home, staggered home, whatever it was. But I got home. You mean to tell me God brought me home? And I think about how I was raised in a wonderful house back in the 1970s. And how I landed in that garage. How I knocked down a telegram. And how two policemen back in 1970 came and picked me up from the house. They didn't bring me to come, and they brought me home. And I was in the back seat, I said, thank y'all. I said, I love the way y'all handle the situation. One of the white officers turned around and said, Ferdinand, you haven't been drinking? I said, no, don't touch it. How can I put down on somebody who mishap? And as you go to jail for one night or whatever the case is, how can I put down on him? Because this was in the 70s, when all black folks not only went to jail for doing stuff wrong, black folks went to jail when they didn't do it.
That's right.
But the Lord was there, showing mercy to me. He said, I'm not going to let them folks bring you into the first night. Because they might like you, and we'll tell them when you're going to. Now, I'm going through all that, I'm going to let you, or I'm going to let man stop me from praising Him now. Like, I'm going to praise Him if I got to praise Him all by myself. But the whole point about it is that you will never have to praise Him by yourself. You know why? Because as God said to Elijah, don't say that to by yourself. I got 7,000 who have not bowed down to Baal. God will always have somebody to worship, somebody to praise Him. Glory to God. Hold up, and I got this last statement to excuse. The Christian life is not few. But it's purposeful, that purpose in this life. Your mind is filled with the light of God's word, and your heart with the fullness of God's life. Give your body to God as an instrument of righteousness, and not sin for the satisfaction of your own selfish lust. Don't live for yourself. You live for God. To live to please Him. That's a path. It's a burden that goes along with it. That is pain, suffering sometimes, rejection. And you have to cry sometimes. But that's all right. His grace is sufficient. If you stay with Him, your latter day is going to be better than your former day. It ain't going to be much better than the beginning. I see the light. Glory, and I will. That's what it's all about. Amen.
Amen.
Now you can rub it up, sir. come and say, yes, Lord, you can come. Let us grab a table of one another. Join our hands together.
Glory, hallelujah, come and hear, as you show this afternoon.